name is Chimani Kwelashli. I'm with the Brown Beret National Organization. You are watching Brown Beret TV. I'm here today with Ernesto Ayala. He is a representative of the Raza Unida Party and also a fellow Brown Beret. We're talking today about Chicano nationalism and the importance of Chicano nationalism in the Chicano movement. Now, from 1967 on up, the belief of Chicano nationalism was predominant in the Chicano movement. It was the belief, the ideology, that spearheaded our campaigns to receive all the rights that we have today. If it wasn't for Chicano nationalism, we would not be here today. None of us would be here today. We would not have any of the rights or privileges in this country that we have today. And it is also a revolutionary type of ideology that believes in Aslan. It believes in self-determination and the betterment of our communities, but it's not an intolerant type of ideology, because we also understand that Chicano nationalism, it benefits a lot of other people as well that live in our communities, because we are not alone in this world and in this country. We are surrounded by people of different colors and of different races, ethnicities, and they have benefited a lot from Chicano nationalism. And one of the things that Chicano the movement has brought about was affirmative action. Now, affirmative action has basically benefited white women. It hasn't really benefited a lot of Chicanos to the extent that it has benefited white women. A lot of black people were benefited. They now have a black president, which is basically white, you know. but he's, you know, the thing is that they at least have representation in the upper government, whereas Chicanos were still struggling. So, today we want to talk about that, and if I can get your thoughts, Evan, what best about this concept?
Yes, basically, like we're talking about, you know, nationalism. People have to understand nationalism, you know, and the differences of, you know, where it comes from. I think, unfortunately, a lot of people, including a lot of Raza, when they hear these terms, nationalism, you know, all the isms, we get scared, you know. Mainly even in the movement, when we hear the term nationalism, a lot of us will get scared. And this is because of, you know, the school system and even a lot of European, you know, white liberal leftist organizations have pushed upon us to believe that nationalism is something bad, you know, that it's a negative force. The reason they do this is because they see things through their perspective, through even though they're calling themselves revolutionaries, they're calling themselves, for example, communists, socialists, etc. And maybe they do feel, you know, that we need to change the system, but they're still seeing things through their point of view, a European point of view, the point of view of someone that has directly or indirectly, you know, privileged from what has happened to our people and other colonized peoples, you know. So when they think of nationalism, they think of the nationalism that, you know, Europeans have used to subjugate other peoples, you know. For supposed patriotism, for example, the United States uses, you know, quote-unquote nationalism, you know, American nationalism, when they're trying to get people ready for a war. You know, when they started invading Iraq, they started saying, "Oh, well, we're the best country on earth. We're the country that provides freedom, and these other, you know, people, they just hate freedom. They don't explain how or why they would hate freedom. You know, why would anyone hate freedom?" But so that's nationalism being used by a colonial force, by a capitalist, by an imperialist. And at the same time, another good example is the nationalism that the people of Iraq have. But their nationalism, they believe that Iraq should belong to the people of Iraq. That all the resources of Iraq should belong and benefit the people of Iraq. And so in the same light, you know, all revolutionary movements, anywhere you go in the world, you know, either started or were nationalist. Even in Europe. When the Russian Revolution broke out, who did the Russian you know, workers, the you know, Bolsheviks and the Communist parties and all these other groups, who did they fight for? They fought for Russians first, you know. And when all the countries in Latin and, you know, quote unquote Latin America, including here Aztlan, which used to be a part of Mexico back then, fought against Spain, you know, they fought with a nationalist, you know, fervor to you know, expel Spain, to kick out the colonizer. Of course, you know, we didn't exactly kick them out completely, you know, they're obviously still here. But, you know, that's the differences in nationalism. Nationalism for the oppressor, from the oppressor, or nationalism from the oppressed. You know, the nationalism from the oppressed aims at uniting our people, aims at, you know, bringing confidence to our people, not only as individuals, but as a nation, as a community. You know, making us feel that we are worth in this world, that we can, you know, we can see eye to eye with, you know, and it's not to go on racial terms, but that we can see eye to eye with a white man, you know, and you know, see him eye to eye and let him know that we too are humans. We too, you know, breathe. We too cry, hate, love, you know, that's what nationalism of the oppressed aims to do, you know, to give that human face to the forgotten and erased people. You know, so nationalism, for us Chicanos, aims to do just that. You know, a lot of people, they mistakenly, you know, are fed this idea that nationalism divides, you know, and I think that's totally untrue when it comes to colonized peoples. Chicano nationalism, Chicano revolution nationalism, our goal, what is our goal, is to unite all of our people. To unite everyone, whether, you know, let's say you are Chicano, or you already identify as Chicano, whether you're Mexicano, whether you're Centro Americano, whether you're you know, native from a reservation, you know, whether you're South American, you know, or even let's say you're not any indigenous, you know, related person, but that you understand and you respect, and maybe even you grew up with among Chicanos, you know, if you're willing to do that, then you are a Chicano to us. And so I can't see any other term and any other reason how you would, you know, consider the Chicano movement, the Chicano revolutionary nationalism, or nationalism from colonized people, to be divisive at all. On the contrary, it's a unifying force, you know. And again, if we see throughout history revolutions, how did they come about, and how, a lot of people say, you know, how did they do it, you know? Well, I mean, of course there was a lot of, you know, conditions that led to it, but the force that made the people unite was nationalism. Every country you go to, if you go to Cuba, what made the people unite? Nationalism made them understand that they had to expel, you know, the U.S. forces and their puppets, you know, which also were, you know, Cubanos, of course, but they weren't doing anything for Cuba or the Cuban people. So it made the Cuban people realize, well, we are Cubanos. Cuba should be for Cubanos, not for foreigners and not for a couple of rich people that don't even care about their you know, countrymen. Anywhere you go in the world.
And Hugo Chavez, that is a perfect example.
Exactly. Hugo Chavez, and, you know, but yet the unfortunate thing is, you know, we have a lot of brothers and sisters that, you know, are fed these lies, or they've come up, you know, to people that profess that nationalism is divisive and petty bourgeois, you know, all these terms that they use. And yet they tend to support nationalist struggles or, you know, revolutionary struggles in other countries, but when it comes for here at home, you know, it's hard for people to understand that here too we have an authentic struggle. And yes, of course, you know, we have people that are not Chicano, like we said before. You have people that are not Chicano, you know, we have people that are not, you know, indigenous. We have, you know, again, our African brothers and sisters who have lived and fought through a lot of similar things that we have, you know. We have, you know, Asian peoples, you know, Pacific Islander peoples. We even have, you know, poor white people who, for the most part, they are used, you know, as, you know, they're duped by the white colonial system to make white workers think that they have something to lose if the colonized people free themselves. Yet the white workers are also being exploited, you know. But our aim in our communities, you know, our people are growing by leaps and bounds. We in many states, in many counties throughout the Southwest, what we call Aslan, we're already the majority. You know, so who is the working class within Aslan? Some could even say who is the working class within the whole United States. It's Raza. It is Raza. The overwhelming majority is Raza people, you know, La Raza, Chicanos, and other Raza, you know. So, you know, we're talking about what is going to unite these people. First and foremost, what is going to unite these people? It's going to be nationalism. You know, it will be very hard. I mean, if it's hard for us to already unite, it would be very hard for our people to unite with someone they don't even know, you know.
Now, there's we've been listening to a lot of the chat that's been going on in different circles, and a lot of so-called Chicanos, and I call them so-called because a Chicano by definition is a nationalist. A Chicano by definition cares about his community, and if you do not believe in nationalism, then you're not really a Chicano. If you believe in internationalism, you're a humanist. You know, you're an internationalist, but don't call yourself a Chicano. You know, especially do not call yourself a Brown Beret. But a lot of these chats that are going around, a lot of people they want to label Chicano nationalism as a hate-filled thing, as a racist thing, because they think that, you know, you're not focusing on other people's struggles around the world. And as you said earlier, you know, they want to point to China. And they want to point to Russia and to Cuba and to Argentina and Brazil and other countries, right? Bolivarian, you know, mm-hmm. Type of revolutions. And when they point out those, but they don't, like you said, they don't really think about the struggle that we're having here as anything genuine or authentic.
Exactly.
That they think that, you know, ours is not really a struggle. But, you know, Che Guevara talked about, you know, the peoples over here, that we are in the belly of the beast.
Exactly.
It's our struggle that is the most important struggle in the world. Because
yep.
if we are able to liberate ourselves here
yep.
and identify ourselves as a nation of people here, we break the back of the beast and we're able to liberate the people in other countries, in all around the world.
If we're authentically concerned about the Palestinians, about the Zapatistas, about, you know, what's going on in South America and Cuba and in Iraq, all these other places, if we're authentically concerned about them, then we have to understand that our where all those problems stem out of is
yeah,
here.
It's right here.
Yeah, it's right here. And the only people that can legitimately counter the biggest empire, the biggest threat to humanity and life on Earth, the only group that can legitimately counter them legally, morally, politically, economically, who is that? That's our people here.
You know, because see, Chicanos, we have a link to the land, and that's our sangre. Now, if you look at us, you know, we are people of color. We are not Europeans. We are not immigrants here. We are indigenous people as well. Some of us have some mixture of some European or even African blood bloodlines. You know, that have mixed in with us. But, you know, the majority of us have that indigenous blood, and that is a link to the land. And so we have a genuine struggle here. We have a genuine reason why we fight. We're not an invading army that's just come here to, you know, overthrow something. We, you know, we belong here. Our people descend from kings and
exactly.
queens and, you know, and emperors and scholars. Intelligent people, intelligent civilizations that existed here long before any Europeans came here.